Thank you very much for the invitation. So I hope you can see the slides. If something is not if you don't see something or you have any questions, so please ask. I will be happy to clarify something. So I will talk about generalization of Witten's conjecture and non-commutative KDV hierarchy. I will possibly try to make some comments about slides and write in blue color. So I will talk about some relation between the intersection theory on the modular space of stable curves and non-commutative integrable systems. To my knowledge, this is the first relation of this sort. A relation between the intersection theory and the usual integrable systems is well developed, and this one is something new. At the moment, it is just one explicit example, but I think it has the potential of giving some new insight in the geometry of the modular space of curves, and possibly open some. Maybe it can have a potential to open some new direction. But okay. So I will talk about non-commutative Carteriak de Vries hierarchy. And here I would like to talk about two results. One is a theorem, and the other is conjecture. So the conjecture is that the intersections with the double ramification cycle in the modular space of curves is described in a very nice way by a non-commutative KDV hierarchy. And why we came to this conjecture? This is because of general phenomenon that we are developing together with Paolo, mostly Paolo Rossi, and we also worked with Boris Dubrovin and Jeremy Guerre. So there is a general phenomenon that there are to any cohomological field theory, one can associate two integrable systems, and conjecturally they're equivalent. We call this conjecture DRDZ equivalence conjecture. And what we did together with Paolo Rossi, we computed the other side of this equivalence, of this correspondence. So we consider so-called double ramification hierarchy for the double ramification cycle. And then as a result, we get a non-commutative KDV hierarchy. And then in this conjecture predicts that the intersections with the double ramification cycles should be described by the same hierarchy. Our result is
can you say immediately, Sasha, can you say immediately what is non-commutative in KDV? What becomes non-commutative?
The variable u and x and its derivatives do not commute. So u doesn't commute with dx, u doesn't commute with ux, ux with uxx, and etc. So U can be, for example, a matrix.
Sorry, is it different from quantum KDV, where U is basically an Andromedan tensor?
Sorry, can you say it again? I didn't hear you well.
Is it different from quantum KDV, where U is an Andromedan tensor? So.
Possibly quantum KDE is a further extension, but I think it's different from quantum KDE. What we consider is different from quantum KDE. So what we did, we'll explain you. So we described in some way intersections of two double ramification cycles and some Hodge class in the modular space of curves.
In this non-commutative KDV, more than just saying that U is in some Lie algebra?
Yeah, you can.
Are there any other examples? What's underlying your understanding of non-commutative KDV? Because usually, it was mentioned several times that it remains integral if U is just a matrix, for
example. Yeah, actually, yeah. Here we use, of course, some concrete non-commutative KDV. So U will be a function of two variables, of two space variables. So in the usual KDV hierarchy, U is a function of one space variables, an infinite number of times. In our non-commutative KDV, U is a function of two space variables, X and Y, and infinite number of times. And their multiplication is given by the Moyal product of functions on the plane.
Thank you.
Yeah. okay, so on the left half, I tried to outline some general picture. First I would like to recall Witten's conjecture, and before that, some basic definitions about the modular space of Kurz. Probably everybody knows that, but still I will recall it very briefly. So we consider nodal Kurz, which are connected compact algebraic Kurz, such that all the singularities are nodes. So a node is a locally the intersection of two lines, in the complex plane. So I will draw two. So a complex curve is a two-dimensional surface. So I prefer to draw two-dimensional pictures. I draw two examples of two nodal curves. And the genius of a nodal curve. Algebraically, it is defined as the dimension of the first cohomology group of the structure of the structural sheaf of the sheaf of functions on our curve, and topologically, it is the same as the genius of a smoothing of a curve. And a smoothing means that locally we have some singularity x y equals zero. Then locally we replace it with a small piece of xy equals epsilon, or small epsilon. So this is a smoothing. Okay, I will go to the next slide. For example, I try to draw what I mean here. So smoothing of the first nodal curve gives a curve of genius one. So you see that this program doesn't make any comments. Okay, in color. Okay, so the first node is, I tried to draw smoothing. So for the first curve, we get a curve of genius one. And for the second curve, we get a curve of genius two. This is to illustrate how
Can you consider like algebraic structure or complex analytic structure on these curves?
Yeah, this is the same. So, I mean, for curves, this is the same.
No, I mean, it like should be depend on your parameter epsilon, right? If you do this smoothing.
Yeah, but you see, of course, when I say that we replace, locally xy equals zero by xy equals epsilon, it means that, I work in complex analytic category. But of course, the resulting curves also algebraic.
Yes, but does it depend on parameter epsilon?
Of course. Smoothing, topologically, when we smooth a curve topologically, all smoothing are the same, but of course, analytically or algebraically, they are different. They can be different, of course.
Thank you.
Yeah, so marked nodal curve is a nodal curve equipped with marked points, ordered marked points x1 xn from the smooth part of the curve, and also pairwise distinct. And the stable curve is a marked nodal curve such that its automorphism group is finite. Okay.
You forget to tell that marked points do not coincide with nodal points. They should be different from nodes.
Actually, maybe my writing is not good. I write it, so I say that Xi belongs to C as smooth part of the curves. But maybe you don't see it. Okay, yeah, it is correct, yeah. So, they cannot, mark points cannot coincide with nodes. I hope everything, you can see everything on my slides well. So if something is hidden by some computer problem, so please tell me. For non-negative G and N, we consider the modular space of stable curves. So we consider the set of all stable curves up to isomorphisms. And this space is non-empty if and only if this condition to G minus 2 plus N greater than 0 is satisfied. In details, it means that if G is zero, then we can have not less than three marked points. If genus is one, then we can have not less than one marked point. And okay, if the genus is two, then the number of marked points is arbitrary. This is an illustration of the fact that, for example, if we have a sphere with marked points, then its automorphism group is finite. If and only if we have at least three marked points. If we have two or one marked point, the automorphism group is infinite. Yeah, when we consider automorphism group of a marked curve, so an automorphism means that an automorphism of a marked curve is an automorphism of a curve that fixes the marked points, point-wise. So this modular space, MGN, it has a natural structure of a complex orbifold of dimension 3g minus 3 plus n. To give some examples, M03 is a point. So if we have a sphere with three marked points, then up to isomorphisms. So all such spheres are isomorphic to each other. So M03 is a point. M04 is a projective line. M05 is a blow up of the product of two P1s at three points. In general, M0n is a smooth complex manifold. Its structure is well understood. We see that M05 can be expressed as a blow up of P1 cross P1, and in general this happens with all M0n. So M0n can be explicitly described as a iterated blow up of the product of P1s. But modular spaces with higher G is much more complicated. Okay, so we'll consider two subspaces in the modular space. So first of all, we can consider smooth curves, only smooth curves, and this gives a subspace in the modular space of stable curves, denoted by MGN. And also, there is another subspace that is considered very often, the so-called modular space of curves of compact type. So for this, we consider only stable curves with separating nodes. So we don't allow a curve, a stable curve, to have non-separating nodes. Here I try to draw what I mean by separating node and non-separating node. So it means that if we have a node, then we can normalize it. So we can unglue two branches. So locally it's x y equals zero. So we can unglue. So locally it's two lines glued at two points. Yeah, and then we can unglue these two lines, and then a node is curve separating if the resulting curve, when we unglue the branches at a node, if the resulting curve is non-connected, and if the resulting curve is connected, still connected, then this node is called non-separating. And then we consider there's this moduli space of curves of compact type. Okay, yes, and then there are natural cohomology classes. Just maybe to say briefly that the moduli space of curves has a very complicated topology, and there is maybe not so much hope to understand the full cohomology of MGN. People concentrate on some subspace in the cohomology groups of the moduli space of curves that is spanned by some natural classes. Then there is a hope that one can at least understand this subspace in the cohomology space of MGN spanned by natural classes. What natural classes we consider? So there are natural line bundles over the moduli space of curves. So if we have a nodal curve, Mark nodal curve, or stable curve, then we can consider the cotangent space at the ith marked point. A point of the moduli space is the isomorphism class of some stable curve. And then over this point, we have this cotangent space at the ith marked point. And all these spaces, they glue in a vector bundle over the moduli space of curves. That is denoted by Li. This line bundle, these line bundles are called the tautological line bundles. And the first Chern classes of these line bundles are denoted by Psi. Psi classes. There is another natural object, natural vector bundle over the moduli space of curves, Hodge vector bundle of rank G. For this, we consider the space of holomorphic one forms on our curve. It is well known that for a smooth curve, for a smooth genus G curve, the space of holomorphic one forms has dimension G. If we consider nodal curves, then one has to define the notion of a holomorphic one form or nodal curve. I will not give a detailed definition. I just say that by definition, a holomorphic one form on a nodal curve is a holomorphic one form on the smooth part, and we allow this form to have only simple singularities at nodes. And we require that the residues at each node, the sum of the residues at two branches is zero. It's an elementary exercise to check that if we define a holomorphic one form on a nodal curve in this way, then still for any nodal curve of genus G, the space of holomorphic one forms on it will be G-dimensional. So, okay, so in this way we get a vector bundle of rank G, and the Chern classes of it are called the Hodge classes. There is an important property that the top Chern class, the Euler class of this vector bundle, vanishes on the complement of the modular space of cursor compact type. So I write this property, lambda g restricted to this complement is zero. Yeah, this is an important property. Conjecturally, it actually fixes this class lambda g up to scaling. Actually lambda g is some important class conjecturally specified by this property. But this property will be important for us. I go to the next slide. I will recall Witten's conjecture. Witten considered intersection numbers, so the integrals over the modular space of over the modular space of stable curves of monomials in psi classes. Degree of this monomial is not equal to the dimension of this space, then we define this integral to be zero. Consider the generating series of these intersection numbers. So we consider four more variables, T0, T1, T2, and epsilon, and consider this generating series of these intersection numbers. This is a formal power series in this infinite number of formal variables. Yes, and then
там опечатка, да? Т в степени ДИТ, наверное, или нет?
It's correct. Indeed, we take the product of TDI. The power of psi class. Psi i to the power of di, it corresponds to the index in the t variable. This definition if one did not see such definition before, it can be a bit confusing because one can see that in this sum many monomials. The coefficients of many monomials are the same, but one can check. I write at the bottom that the intersection number is equal to the coefficient of epsilon to the power 2g of this derivative, this nth derivative of this function f evaluated at zero. This remark at the bottom indeed shows that this formal power series contains all information about the intersection numbers. Witten derived the following two basic equations for the intersection numbers, the string equation and the Dilaton equation. He conjectured that the second derivative with respect to T0 of this function f satisfies the KdV equation, quadratic Defries equation. Normalized in this way. So quadratic Defries equation can have normalizations. So okay, normalized in this way, where we identify x with T0. This is a very deep statement. It has at the moment it has many proofs. In the brackets I listed only part of the proofs. I think they're probably twice more. I just want to make a remark that although there are many proofs, there are not so many geometric ideas on which one can compute these intersection numbers. So all these many proofs use a restricted number of geometric ideas. Yeah, and I tried to list it. Proofs that use different ideas. So proofs Kantsevich, Kunkov, Pankhripanda, Kadrian Landau, Mirzakhani, and also there's a recent proof of Alexandrov, Iglesias, Shadrin, from the last year, which uses a new geometric approach to this computation. The remark made by Witton in his original paper that actually these three equations, the string equation, the Dilaton equation, and the KdV equation, they uniquely determine the function f. It's a non-trivial fact because one can see that. On the left hand side, so these equations only the derivatives with respect to t0 and t1 appear. So maybe one can ask how. One could expect that higher derivatives should appear. There is a non-trivial argument saying that the function f is uniquely reconstructed from these three equations.
Is it really three equations, or it's even enough to require string equation if you have the whole hierarchy?
No, it's not enough. Dilaton is crucial. So using Dilaton together with KdV, one reconstructs W completely, the function W. And then one can integrate, find F using the string equation. Dilaton is crucial here. Without Dilaton, one cannot find the function. I think no, it's impossible. I go to the next slide. There is even more structure. The second derivative of the function f satisfies the whole KdV hierarchy, which is an infinite sequence of infinitesimal symmetries of the KdV equation. here I write the second equation of the KdV hierarchy, but there are infinitely many. All these flows pairwise commute. This is non-trivial. This is a very non-trivial algebraic property of the KdV equation. This was a remarkable achievement. I think in 70s or in 60s, observing that the KdV equation has an infinite sequence of infinitesimal symmetries. I would like to go to generalization of Witton's conjecture, but first I would like to introduce the non-commutative KdV hierarchy. Using the Lux representation of the classical KdV hierarchy. I guess everybody knows this material, but still I recall it. All these laws of the KdV hierarchy can be explicitly described using the following technique. So one considers pseudo-differential operators. Infinite series, Lorentz series, A capital of this form. Where we consider dx as a form of formal variable. And the coefficient, the coefficients are formal power series in t's with coefficients that are Laurent polynomials in epsilon. One can define the positive part of such a pseudo-differential operator and the purely negative part. Then there is a ring structure in this in the space of pseudo-differential operators given by this formula. dx times f gives the following expression. So you see that if k is positive, then the result will be a differential operator, because only finitely many coefficients will be non-zero. But if k is negative, then on the right-hand side you get an infinite sequence. So and this rule endows the space of pseudo-differential operators with the structure of associative algebra, non-commutative associative algebra. Yes, and then this is a nice algebra where one can take roots. So if we have a pseudo-differential operator that starts from dx to some power plus some lower terms, suppose this power is positive, then there exists a unique pseudo-differential operator of the form dx plus lower terms, such that this a tilde to the power r is a. So you see that this is a root. This is a root of a. So now the rth root of a. And then the KDV hierarchy has the following description. So we consider differential operator dx squared plus 2 epsilon minus 2w, and then the flows of the KDV hierarchy are given by this commutator. If one did not see such expressions before, then one can have several questions. For example, dl, the derivative of l, should be a function, but on the right hand side we have the commutator of two differential operators. So why the right hand side is a function? There's a simple argument showing that the right hand side is actually a function. And also also elementary computation shows that all the flows of the hierarchy pairwise commute. The double factorial is defined in this way. The definition involves epsilon to the power minus 2, but actually the flows of the KDV hierarchy have this form. So dw over dti is 1 over I plus 1 factorial, the x derivative of w to the power I plus 1 plus some terms in epsilon. Terms with epsilon inverse. So the dispersionless part. So the dispersionless part means that we put epsilon to zero. The dispersionless part is just 1 over I plus 1 factorial, the x derivative of w to the power I plus 1. Okay, this is KDV hierarchy. Right, that the flows pairwise commute. And this is a purely algebraic property. So we can try to compute the derivative with respect to ti, and then the derivative with respect to tj. You can see that the right hand sides up of the KDV hierarchy are polynomials. If you compute two derivatives, then you get some polynomial in W's and its derivatives. And then you can try to compute in the other direction. And then, the result will be the same. So this is pairwise commutativity of the flows. this means that the hierarchy has a unique solution for an arbitrary initial condition. We'd like to introduce non-commutative KDV hierarchy. And then the remarkable fact here is that actually the classical construction using the Lux operators works without any changes if variables w, wx, so if w's and its derivative, if w and its derivatives do not commute. So we can consider an arbitrary associative, not necessarily commutative, algebra A, calligraphic A, with multiplication that I would like to denote by star. And suppose W and W1, W2 are some elements of A. And then suppose we have some linear operator in A such that dx of wi is wi plus 1, the Leibniz rule is satisfied. Yeah, and the Leibniz rule is satisfied. Yes, and then it occurs that we can we can use the same then we can define we can consider the space of pseudo differential operators and define the ring structure in this space by the same formulas. Yes, and then define the the flows of the KDV hierarchy by the same formula with the commutator. So yeah, it actually one can check, it's an elementary exercise to check that actually everything works. Everything works, so one gets the right hand side, so the flows will commute. So when I write this commutator with you see the commutator with this star, we just to emphasize that we are using some non-commutative multiplication. Just traditionally people write this star as the index is this sign of the commutator. Okay, and then the first equation of the non-commutative KDV hierarchy is this one. It's the same as for the usual KDV hierarchy, but you see that if we have a commutative, a usual KDV hierarchy, then actually the initial term is equal to WWX, of course. But here, it's not equal. So the initial term, the dispersionless term is like I write. So it's 1/2 W star WX. And then the other flows of the KDV, of the non-commutative KDV hierarchy has this form. So the dispersionless part is easy. So it's W to the I plus 1th power X derivative divided by I plus 1 factorial. But we will use some concrete non-commutative KDV hierarchy, which is given by the following. So let us consider the functions on the real plane, and then for example, smooth functions or formal power series, and then we would like to consider the following product in the space of in the space of functions. So f star g is this one. So we write exponent of this differential operator, and then these arrows over these derivatives mean that we apply the derivative to the corresponding side. We consider some exponents, so we expand it, we consider the Taylor expansion. I hope this is understandable. Below I write the explicit formula for this product. So you see that it's a deformation of the usual product. It's a deformation of the usual product. So when mu is zero, we get usual product. So epsilon mu are formal variables. Epsilon mu are formal variables. And also maybe another thing to say about this Moyal product is that if you can consider the commutator of two functions using this Moyal product, then the leading term of this commutator will be the Poisson bracket of these two functions with respect to the standard symplectic structure on R2. So this Moyal product is maybe one of the first explicit constructions of the product structure in the space of functions on the plane, such that the commutator, the leading term of the commutator is given by this standard Poisson structure. Okay. So
what's the reason for keeping epsilon and mu for as two separate letters? So why don't
you... Sasha, excuse me, but why did you choose this specific...
Sorry, can you say it again? I think the connection was not good, so...
As I understand, why you keep both epsilon and mu, though they appear just as a product?
Because of the following. So yeah, in the following geometric considerations, they will have different meanings. So.
And so you mentioned already this x and y. So is x the same x as it was in KdV equation?
Yeah, the same.
Why you just have an extra variable to make this non-commutative?
Yes, exactly. Probably there was some other question, continue.
So my question was, will it be?
Sorry, again. So.
Sorry, Petty, your connection is really bad. Maybe you can put it in the chat.
You can send to the chat your question, and someone will try to understand it.
Actually, there is already. If one will try to check the chat. So if one has questions
And also maybe a question: this non-commutative KdV, does it have any simple solutions?
There is a literature about this non-commutative KdV with this Moyal product. They consider solitons. So there are many.
There are solitons. How they're different from ordinary commutative solitons?
I didn't study this, so I saw papers about it, but didn't study.
Andrei, this is similar to spin. For example, simplest example would be just like spin Kolmogorov-Moser system arises in this way. When you consider matrix version of KP. So this is a prototype of how it looks like.
Okay, and so can you say so that if we just take this version which Sasha presented with extra Y variable, what will be the spin?
Saying for non-commutative, you ask not for this particular choice, but I believe it's the construction of soliton goes straight away, so it should go.
Okay.
I'd like to ask about these non-commutative equations. Are they also Hamiltonian equations like the ordinary KdV?
Yes, I think so. I think more or less the same Hamiltonians work.
But can you describe the symplectic structure or Poisson bracket?
I think the first bracket should work. It should be just dx and the Hamiltonians are just residues of the powers of the operator L. Regarding the second, I'm not sure. So regarding the second Poisson structure, I'm not sure.
Okay, thanks.
Pete asked the question through chat. So why I chose to consider this algebra? It will be clear later. The intersections, with double verification cycles will give a solution of this non-commutative KdV with this Moyal product. Okay. Yeah. So we will consider when we say non-commutative KDE hierarchy, we will consider only this KDE with this Mayal product. Yes, and then classical KDE is recovered when we put mu equals zero. So we have introduced a non-commutative KDE hierarchy. Then I would like to go back to the geometry of MGN. Introduce the double verification cycle. So we consider an n tuple of integers with the vanishing sum. Sometimes I will denote this tuple of nth tuple of integers by A capital. Then if not all the AIs are zero, then the double verification cycle can be described in this way. It's not the full definition, but at least I think it gives some essential information. So we consider first MGN, the modular space of smooth curves, and consider a natural subspace formed by curves C such that this divisor A1 X1 AN XN is a principal divisor. It occurs that this condition gives a subspace suborbifold of complex codimension G. We want to consider some. So this is in the modular space of smooth curves, but we want to consider to get some cohomology class on MGN, and one has to consider some extension. So I put this bar. Usually bar means the closure, but this is not the closure. This is some other extension to the whole modular space of curves, to the whole modular space of stable curves. I prefer not to give the full definition here. Possibly if we will have time, so I will give the definition. But
What is principal divisor? Forgive my ignorance.
Principal means that there exists a function such that this divisor is the divisor of this function.
So it's like, but your curve is compact, right?
Compact.
So it must have degree zero.
So it's
linear, equivalent to zero divisor.
Equivalent to zero. So there is some extension. So then we can take the Poincaré dual class and get some cohomology class in MGN. Then this class can be also defined when all the AIs are zero. And just as a remark, actually, the resulting class is simple. So DRG of zeros is just minus one to the power of G lambda G. We will not use. I can now make remarks in color. So strangely, before I couldn't do that. But this remark is not important for us. Below I list the properties that are important. So the engineer zero, the double verification cycle is simple. It's just one in the cohomology. When I say cohomology, I mean cohomology with rational coefficients. Then highly non-trivial result is that the double verification cycle is a polynomial in AIs of degree 2G with the coefficients in this cohomology group of MGN. It's a polynomial, not necessarily homogeneous, of degree 2G. So this is a relatively recent result of Janda, Poincaré-Panda, Pixton, Zvonkin, and they also presented a more or less explicit formula for it. It's explicit, but quite complicated. If we restrict to the modular space of curves of compact type, then this is an older result. This was proved earlier that the double verification cycle restricted to the modular space of curves of compact type is a homogeneous polynomial in AIs of degree 2G. And for this, there is a very simple formula called Hine's formula, which I will recall later. Yeah, so here are the most important properties of the double verification cycle. Yeah, so now I go to the next slide. Now we want to consider the intersections of psi classes with this cycle. So we introduce formal variables T. So having two indices, the lower goes from zero to infinity, and the upper index belongs to integers. Is an integer, yeah. And then we, I don't want to denote it by f hat will be later. Sorry. So this is FDR. So. I would like to consider I would like to consider these integrals of the product of double verification cycle with the monomial in psi classes. So I would like to consider these integrals and basically consider the generating series. That is why I put this monomial in T's. So it keeps track of all these. Of all these numbers, yeah. And then again, so you can see that this putting epsilon mu together looks a bit stupid. But later we will consider some extension of the double verification cycle where they will be separated. They will contain different information. So you see, we consider the generating series. So it's a huge formal power series. Before we had an infinite number of variables indexed by just one non-negative integer. Now we have an infinite number of variables indexed by two integers. So big formal power series. Yeah, and then we want to consider these derivatives, WDRA. The derivative with respect to this second derivatives. We would like to make this trick. So we would like to consider this generating series. So WDR is the sum of WDRAs. Yeah, and we put epsilon exponent. So e to the power I AY.
So may I ask you again?
Yeah.
T, these two indices for T. It's not a power T to the power AI, it's just index.
Yeah, it's an index, yeah. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, it's an index. Yeah, index.
We consider
this WDR. Some now one function of these t's, epsilon, mu, and y. Then we want to introduce this formal, some simple formal power series in z. Yes, and then we want to make this transformation. So go from w to u, from 2u. You see that s is some formal power series starting from one, so it is invertible. So actually, this expression is some differential operator in dx and dy, some relatively simple thing. Yes, and then the conjecture is that now UDR satisfies the dispersionless non-commutative KdV hierarchy, where we identify x with t0, and we use the Moyal product. So so there's this conjecture. I would like to observe the full non-commutative KdV hierarchy. And in particular, I said that non-commutative KdV hierarchy
is a generalization of the classical. So when mu is zero, then yeah, we go to the classical KdV hierarchy. And here I would like to get the same. So I would like to get some geometric thing. Yes, and then I would like to get Witten's conjecture, putting mu to zero, mu equals zero. Yeah, and then there is a nice class that is already constructed. That we can consider. But first, let us recall Heinz formula for the double ramification cycle. So restricted to the modular space of curves of compact type. It occurs that the double ramification cycle restricted to the modular space of curves of compact type is more or less the G power of just some cohomology class of degree 2, so some theta class. So you see a very simple formula where theta is this very explicit class. So you see theta is just sum of psi i's, okay, minus sum of boundary classes. So here, I have to explain what is this aj. And aj is just sum of aj capital is just sum of a's, okay, just some coefficient, and then we have this delta, and delta is the standard class defined in this way. So then, there is a big formula for delta, but you can look at it and see that it's actually quite simple. So what we do, we consider curves, so C, stable curves, having only one node, so only one node, which is separating. And then we require that the marked points indexed by this set J capital is on the left component, and the other marked points are on the right component. So maybe I can write here. So other points. So on the left hand side we have only points indexed by J capital. The left hand side has a genius. The left part has genius H, and the right part has genius G minus H. So we take the set of such curves and then take the closure. This is really the closure in MGN bar. And then take the Poincaré rule. This is a cohomology class of degree 2. So when we restrict to compact type, this double ramification cycle becomes very simple. I must say that the whole formula and the full formula for the modular space of stable curves is substantially more complicated. Some important remark that theta to the power of the g plus one restricted to compact type is zero. This is a non-trivial relation between the cohomology classes on the modular space of curves of compact type. Actually in their studies for the double ramification cycle, Janda, Podkhrypan, Pixen, and Zvonkin, they defined an extension of the double ramification cycle. They defined now some class DRG hat in mixed degree. I will not give a definition because I think it will occupy some time, but at least the main properties which allow to get some feeling about this class. So this is some class in mixed degrees, so in degrees between 0 and 2g, so degree 0, 2, 4, and etc. 2g, so sorry, this is misprint mgn bar. The top part, so drg g, is just the usual double ramification cycle. So it's a deformation of the usual double ramification cycle. Then the lower part is just one. Yes. Then all these classes are polynomials. So they are polynomials. Yeah, and also, yes. So if we restrict to, so we have this last property that if we restrict to MGN compact type, that then we get this more or less ith power of the theta class. Yeah. So there is this nice class constructed by these people. Yeah, it has actually more nice properties. This actually class dr hat. This class is form a partial cohomological field theory. So actually, yeah, this is a nice class. Okay, and then it occurs that if we insert this class, then we get the full. If we consider the integrals of monomials psi classes with this class, then we really get the full non-commutative KDV. So now we define this F hat. So now you see, now we finally see that mu and the epsilon have different meanings. Yeah, so epsilon controls the genus G and mu controls this J. The particular part of this extended class. Okay, yeah, so basically we would like to consider the integrals with these classes, with these extended classes, and consider the Jenetian series. So more or less the previous formula, but we just introduced mu to the power 2g, and here we put this guy. The result is again some huge some huge formal power series. Yeah, and then we do the same. So we consider the second derivatives. Yeah, and then we consider this function w hat. And then we do the same transformation, using this operator. Where I recall that S is some very simple, some simple series. Yeah, and then the conjecture, our conjecture with Pavarotti is that this UHDR satisfies the full non-commutative KDV hierarchy. So I just basically write again the equation of this hierarchy. And the first equation. Yeah, and then there was a nice remark is that so now we can see that classical Witten's conjecture is a particular special case. So when we put mu equals zero, then this this operator is one. The Moyal product becomes the usual product. Yes, and then if we put, yeah, you see, we had this property that when we put, if we consider dr, this zero part of the deformation, that is just one. So yeah, when we put mu equals zero, so mu equals zero, so here you see, then it means that j is zero. So we are integrating just the product of psi classes. Okay, and then we have to also to put all t's with higher indices not equal to zero. So here, to zero, okay, and then we get really Witten's formal power series. And then okay, these observations show that if we put epsilon zero and all these t's to zero, then really this star equation gives Witten's conjecture. So as I said, I think this is I think this is a beautiful fact. So we have Witten's conjecture. Then we consider some I think relatively natural classes, double replication cycles. Yeah, and then in this way we get this generalization where the non-commutative KDV hierarchy appears. So this is at the moment this is just one example, but I think that this yeah, this relation is enough beautiful to be able to hope that this relation can clarify some questions about the structure of the MGN bar. In particular, because the double verification cycles, they find, especially in recent years, they find more and more applications. So, So these double verification cycles, they're quite useful classes. So, many properties about the cohomology of MGN bar can be proved using them. So okay, I will not give precise reference, but okay. And then I have some time. I will. So this is a conjecture, but I would like to speak about the motivation. The motivation is that so we actually have computed something together with Paolo. Here on the left part, I would like to present some general picture. So how we come to this conjecture? So there are cohomological field theories, and there are two constructions of integrable hierarchies associated to them. There is the De Broglie-Jung hierarchy, and then introduced by De Broglie-Jung. And then there is another construction, DR hierarchy, which I introduced some time ago. And then I basically say that this is hard. I mean that computations of the De Broglie-Jung is hard, and then this is much easier. Actually, I mean these are much easier. And then there is a conjecture that these two hierarchies are related by a polynomial change of variables. And then in our joint work with Dubrovinger and Rossi, we observed that actually this double verification hierarchy works for partial cohomological field theories. We obtained a lot of information about this conjectural change of variable. Change variables between the two hierarchies, and also in our work with Paolo Rossi, we observed that actually this construction of the double verification hierarchy works even for partial cohomological theories of infinite rank. And then we made this explicit computation for the partial cohomological field theory of infinite rank given by this extended DR cycle of Ponthierry-Panda, of Yanda, Ponthierry-Panda, Pixton, Zwonkin. And then we computed the DR hierarchy for this guy, and then we get this non-commutative KDV. Using this conjecture about the equivalence, we get the other side, and then this gives the conjecture that I have just presented. I want to explain what. So I won't have enough time to explain this equivalence and the general construction of double verification hierarchy and the Broglie-Jung. I will just try to explain how to get some system of equations using these DR head cycles. So how to construct the double verification hierarchy for these classes. For this, we have to do this formal construction. So we have to introduce, so we would like to introduce these formal variables, PAB. So in the upper right corner, so here A and B are integers. So again, they're indices, so A is not a power, it's an index. We want to consider this object. So here they are in round brackets. So we would like to consider the integral over MGN plus one, of the product of this extended cycle, lambda G class, psi class, and the usual double verification cycle. Yes, so so some complicated, quite complicated actually expression, much more complicated, looks much more complicated that than we considered before. but actually not so much complicated. So so what is the result? So we consider the generating series of these objects. This is a formal power series in P, the epsilon and mu. Then actually, so here you see we put lambda g, and then from the fact that lambda g vanishes on the complement of the modular space of curves of compact type, it's a bit strange that I write in this way. So, lambda g restricted is equal to zero. it is equal to the to theta to the power j over j factor of lambda g. So actually, this doesn't have to know this class on MGN bar. Yeah, so one only can use only actually Heinz theta class. So remember that theta was a quadratic polynomial in A's. Theta. And then here we have drg of B's times lambda j. And then actually it again means that this lambda j times drg is a polynomial, homogeneous polynomial of degree 2g. So I just want to say that it's a formal power series. So so this expression in these brackets is a polynomial in two groups of variables. So it's a polynomial in A's and in B's of by degree 2G, 2G, 2G. Yes, and then there is a trick how to get some system of partial differential equations from these expressions. So we would like to introduce now variables UKL using this rule. And then the claim is that using this change of variables, one can transform this GD bar as a formal, which is a formal power series in P is epsilon mu, to an expression of this sort, where GD is some formal power series in U's, epsilon, and mu. And then here we have to use the rule that the integral, the double integral of the exponent, is okay. We have this formula. I hope you see this rule. Nothing hides it. So I would like to explain this trick. So because I guess that if one did not see it before, it can look confusing. So it will be on the next page. So but what I would like to say about this GD bar. So you see that this is a formal power series in P's. So it's some formal power series. So we have some monomials, the product of P's. And the coefficient of this monomial, this thing is a polynomial in A's and B's. And then actually there's a general statement that such formal power series can be converted to such integrals. And then I would like to explain on the next page. So examples. So this is actually an elementary thing. So suppose we have an expression of this sort. So sum, remember that a1 plus a2 was zero and b1 plus b2 was zero. So suppose we have a sum of this sort. This sum. And then you see that indeed, it is equal to this integral, because indeed, so if you put instead of u, the sum of PAB, this exponent, and then use this rule that the double integral of this exponent, is zero. Yeah, so okay, this delta, this rule with Kronecker deltas. You see that actually, and this integral indeed is this sum. Yes, and then another example is, suppose, okay, we have the same thing, so quadratic polynomial, quadratic thing in P, so some quadratic thing, but then the coefficient is some non-trivial polynomial in A, so A1 squared, B2 squared. Then I claim that this is the double integral of zero of U0 to U2 0 dx dy. why is that? Because you see U0 to is what? Is dy squared u. So this is minus sum a squared. Yeah, okay. So this thing. And u to zero is this one. Okay, and then if you multiply these two things. So multiply. And take the integral, then you exactly the integral actually gives this condition. The integral. This condition is more or less this integral. So taking integral means that we require that the sum of A's and the sum of B's is zero. So you see that this gives a rule, concrete rule how to convert this formal power series in P's to expressions of this. Expressions of this sort. From this we can get a system of partial differential equations. So we can define the variational derivative. By the standard formula. The variational derivative. Of functions. With two spaces. So we have. Functionals on the space of. Functions in two space variables definition of variational derivative and then then we can construct this system of partial differential equations with two space variables and then the claim is that it coincides with the non-commutative KDE hierarchy. Where the multiplication is the Mouillard product. So this is what we proved. And then just to give you a feeling how we prove such statements. I just present the main steps. So not even the sketch, just to present the three steps for the proof. So it occurs that, first of all, there is a general result that these flows pairwise commute. Okay, this is a general result. So and then it occurs that if we know G1 bar and the commutativity of the flows, which we know, then this it defines uniquely all the flows. Strictly speaking, we have to know some small initial part of this GD bars, but more or less, G1 bar and commutativity of the flows, it determines all the flows. This is easy, so it's technical. And then, it is sufficient to prove that G1 bar is this expression. So the degree reasons plus actually this property, this vanishing, gives actually the last term of this Hamiltonian, this one. This is also easy. And the essential part is the computation regarding this this thing. Yes, and for this, we have to, so this the last thing that I will write, I think, to get the term integral of u star 3 over 6 dx dy, one has to prove that, studies carefully what all these tricks and going from U to P means, then one comes that one has to prove that. Okay, and I will try to look in our paper. One has to prove the following formula. That integral of mg3 of lambda g dr g minus a1 minus a2 a1 a2 times trg minus b2 one b2, and this is equal to some very explicit thing. G factorial. One over g factorial. A1 B2 minus A2 B1 to the power 2G over 2 to the power 2G 2G plus 1 double factorial. This is actually the main part. The main part of the proof, the computation of these things.
I'm somewhat confused. You consider here integral over mg3.
Yeah.
But I thought your notation for the double ramification cycle is four arguments, means that.
Thanks for the question. One can relate these integrals using the Dilaton equation. So indeed, for the computation of G1, one needs actually a slightly different integral. This guy. So we need psi 1, psi 1 lambda G, drg of 0. Let me just to save some time, denote this by A and this by B. So drg A, drg 0 B. So we have an extra point. So there is a simple relation called the Dilaton relation, that this is equal to two g minus 2 plus 3, so 2 g plus 1, the integrals that I consider, so mg 3 lambda g dr g a dr g b. I just maybe comment that here I use the standard fact, noticed maybe by Witten or maybe other people. So we have the forgetful map from MGN plus 1 to MGN, forgetting the last marked point. So here we forget the point. And then P the push forward of psi. Okay, if we forget the last marked point, then the push forward of psi n plus one is 2g minus 2 plus n. Yeah.
Sorry, but I still don't understand. I thought that the classes are the cohomology classes denoted by DRG and then a number of arguments. The number of arguments equals the number of marked points. But
yeah,
near your cursor, you have DR of 0, comma, and then four numbers.
Yeah.
Which makes together 5. But the moduli space you consider in this situation with 4 mark points.
Well, why do you say 5? Because you see A capital is minus A1 minus A2.
Comma. There is no comma.
I
thought, now it's clear. Thank you. I thought there is a comma between minus A minus A2. It's okay. Thank you. It's my stupidity. Sorry.
I think that's all that I wanted to say. Thank you for the attention.
Maybe at this moment it's good to ask, is it possible to consider cycles which are defined similarly to your double ramification cycle, but when you require that the divisor is equal not to zero, I mean, in the as a class of divisors, zero, but is by some other value, for example, it is equals to the divisor of cotangent bundle or something like that.
Yeah.
Is it possible to consider such cycles?
Actually, these cycles are now intensely studied. There are beautiful results about them. You can look. Started with this recent works of the same people: Pandharipande, Pixton, Zvonkin, Yanda. There are beautiful relations. Of these cycles with, for example, Witten's class. Witten's R-spin class. But regarding relations with integrable systems, this is not done. So I guess one can do some interesting things, but they are not done at the moment.
Yet another question. It seems that, I can vaguely remember that there were some theorems on conjectures, I don't know, that all the cohomology ring of the moduli space is generated, maybe stably, G goes to infinity, or N goes to infinity, I don't remember, is generated only by psi and lambdas. Is it? Do you know something like that? I simply don't remember that, but there was something similar to what I'm saying.
Of course, there is this statement about MG that one can have to introduce kappa classes, so kappa I, which is the push forward of psi to the power i plus one, so it's h to I in MG, okay, bar. And then indeed the cohomology, if G is large, then all the cohomology is generated by kappa classes.
Mm-hmm.
And there are similar conjectures about, this is a theorem, so there is a similar thing about MGN, and one has to use psi kappa and psi and psi classes. But I don't know about any such results about, or even conjectures about MGN. I don't know.
I see. Conjectures were only about non-competitive. But nevertheless, even in this case, it means that I can express the double ramification class in terms of psi's and lambdas.
Yeah, this is not interesting because there is this this zero, so double ramification cycle restricted to MGN is zero.
Ah, it's trivial.
Yeah,
I see. But if I okay, thank you.
Sasha, I have a general question. So somehow you say that from your result with mu put in zero, you'll get the old result of the proof, new proof of Witten's conjecture. So where are the difficulties usually we see in proving this result?
The difficulties, to compute, the difficulties usually how to compute, some integral of some cohomology class, over the modular space of curves. But actually at the moment, this particular conjecture, our particular conjecture is actually now purely algebraic because all these integrals can be computed. Yeah, because as I said, so for example, where is our conjecture? So there is explicit formulas for everything, for this DR class.
So besides DR class, you have psi's. So in one or other way, you should need to get a recurrent relation for this type of classes.
The recurrent relation.
Are you using this for, so you need not only recurrent relations for double ramification part, but also for psi classes. So are you saying that it's already incorporated, the old proofs of Witten's conjecture in your computation?
For example, this is a conjecture we did not prove. So, if one wants to compute these integrals, one can use usual Witten's conjecture, of course. One can use the formula, for example, for this DR, this extended class, and then in order to compute the integral with psi classes, use Witten's conjecture. To be honest, if one wants to compute, this was a part of other talk. I just tried to a new page. these integrals MGN DR usual double ramification cycle A1 AN psi 1 D1 psi N DN. So this is equal to what I said DRGG. A1, AN. For this, there is explicit formula. Formula. In our work with Shadrin, Spitz, Zvonkin.
By explicit formula, you mean recurrent relation?
No, it's really explicit. So we get some formal power series explicitly described using this S function, actually. Really explicit, not a recurrent relation. Explicit formula, which actually does not use Witten's conjecture. It uses only geometry of the double ramification cycles. So, this means that actually I formulated two conjectures. So there was a dispersionless KDV. So this conjecture where we considered only the integrals via DRG. Then actually, so you see, it's very explicit. So I think this is easier because here, it really becomes some algebraic manipulation with this. I think one can, it should be possible to prove it using some algebraic manipulations with our formula, with Shadrian, Spitz, Zvonkin. But this extended conjecture, I think it's more complicated because it includes the integrals with more general classes.
Yeah. I'm asking because KDV or all other hierarchies, it's just a nice way to write recurrent relation between coefficients of the power series. So on one side, KDV is a certain relation. On the other side, you should need to prove the same relation for cohomology classes. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, and it should, something in the geometry of the modular space should be done, not just algebraic manipulation. That's why I'm asking where it is hidden. Is it hidden in explicit already done computation of double ramification cycle? Where?
Yeah, to, if I'm, yeah, I'm not sure that, yeah, I hope that I understand your question correctly. So, yeah, so we have, for example, yeah, even classical KDV, KDV hierarchy. Yeah, then we have, yeah, okay, we have some, okay, some relations for flows. Yes, and then indeed, these relations known in the theory of integrable systems, they give some relations, for the intersection numbers for Mg and bar. Some recursions. But if one uses these, yeah, some relations, yeah, from mathematical physics. So I mean, some, for example, by Hamiltonian or something different. And if one gets these relations for intersection numbers, but for them there are no direct geometric proofs. Yeah, according to my knowledge, there are no direct geometric proofs. All proofs are, they use some geometric idea plus some highly non-trivial algebraic manipulations. There are no direct.
No, there are simple geometric arguments for getting, for example, Virasoro constraints. It's very simple.
But what do you mean, not logic geometric? But okay, maybe I don't know something.
But you still there should be something from geometry of this modular space that tells you how cycles intersect each other.
Yeah, I agree. Yes, I agree.
So I am wondering where this hidden in all what you presented today. There should be.
I agree. Yeah, that it would be, yeah. But I don't know.
Any other questions?
I still have a question. Why do you call these cycles double ramification?
Because, yeah, you see,
this multiplicity is like for Hurwitz spaces, when you prescribe multiplicities of poles of your function. Here you prescribe multiplicities of ramification over infinity and zero.
Yeah.
That's why it's called double ramification.
Uh-huh. Okay, thank you.
So the function for which this divisor is principal divisor divides you a cover of your curve onto the projective line with prescribed multiplicities, A, B, multiplicities over poles and zeros.
Okay, thank you.
More questions? Okay, then, Sash, thanks. And once again, please check before the next our meeting, what's the right link for the Zoom meeting, because probably it will be changed before the next time for some technical reason. Okay. then we just, if there are no more questions, then thanks, speaker, again, and bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.